Coming up next on This Week in Computer Hardware, we talk about the RX 480 power issues being resolved, the world's fastest SSD is tested, and NVIDIA announces the GTX 1060. It's all coming up next on TWiCH.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiCH.
Bandwidth for TWiCH is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is TWiCH, This Week in Computer Hardware, episode 371, recorded on July 7th, 2016. RX 480 power issues disappear. This episode of This Week in Computer Hardware is brought to you by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like a caller ID for your home. Go to ring.com/TWiCH and get $50 off one of their Ring of Security kits, the bundle kit or the pro bundle kit, with their limited time offer. And by iFixit, introducing the all-new ProTech Toolkit to give you the compact and complete toolkit for all things DIY. For $5 off your purchase of $10 or more, go to ifixit.com/TWiT and enter the code TWiCH at checkout. Hey everybody, welcome to TWiCH This Week in Computer Hardware. I'm Ryan Shrout. Patrick is out today attending to some other matters, but no worries. Here at the table next to me, Allyn Malventano is joining us. No Skype delay on this on this call, so we should be good. It has been a busy week in computer hardware. There's been a lot of stuff going on, a lot of launches, some controversies we'll talk about.
Yep.
It's actually interesting. So we'll just go ahead and jump into the news of the week. The we talked about it last week with Patrick. It was kind of just starting to take place there.
Yep.
This whole idea of a power issue with the Radeon RX 480 occurred, right? Where this is a 150-watt TDP card that was found to be drawing more than 150 watts in many cases.
Yeah.
And maybe, you know, probably more concerning than that is how much power it was specifically drawing through the PCI Express slot on the motherboard, mm-hmm. right? So if you look at a video card, right, most video cards that are, you know, mainstream or above have two ways of getting power to the card. You have the PCI Express slot on the bottom, mm-hmm. which has data and power connections, and you have an external power connection, which is maybe a little bit hard to see in this light. There it is. That is a 6-pin PCI Express power connection, right? An external power connection. They have 6-pin, 8-pin. Some cards will have 2 6-pins. Some cards will have 2 8-pins. Sometimes you'll have an 8 and a 6. So regardless, that's how you get power into it, right? The RX 480 was doing something interesting in that it was basically just drawing half of the power it needed from the 6-pin connection and half of the power it needed from the PCI Express bus on the motherboard.
Which is abnormal.
It is abnormal. I went back and looked through a lot of data that we had captured over the last year or so, not looking for this specific problem at the time, but looking for this specific concern now, mm-hmm. and never really found an instance where that was the case.
Right.
Now, obviously, if you have a video card that is like a 75-watt TDP that doesn't have an external connection, that's mm-hmm. a different thing, right? But never did I see one where the 6-pin or an 8-pin and the PCI Express were kind of going up one-to-one
yep.
in terms of power consumption.
And there are cards in the past that would typically go a little bit over on the 6-pin and the 8-pin connectors. And they can kind of get away with that because those contacts are rated for a much higher current than what the PCI Express certification guys put in the spec initially. Like, that part of the spec is really based more on how much heat can you remove from a given, like, standard PCI right. using system or something like that, right? So, I mean, you got all sorts of people, drawing more power from things in computers, and as long as they use a better case and better cooling, like, everything's just fine.
Right.
So, those slots, those pin connectors on top can handle much more than the 75 watts for a 6-pin or 150 watts for an 8-pin that the organization specifies for it, right, as a limit. However, the slot has a pretty hard limit of 5.5 amps that's derived from, like, if you look up the data sheet for the actual PCI connector itself on a motherboard, it's only rated at 1.1 amps per pin. There's 5 pins that supply that 12 volts to the card.
Right.
The math checks, right? It's just 5.5 amps. You really shouldn't go over that. And all those previous cards have never gone over that specific limit.
Right.
Which is a bit more of a sensitive thing, right? There's small traces on the motherboard. The pins are pretty small for the slot.
Especially when you compare it to the beefy...
Yeah, the really kind of beefy 6-pin and 8-pin connectors on top.
Right.
You know, you can kind of... You can go a little bit past the wattage ratings on those just fine without really any issue. And, you know, doesn't actually exceed the physical limits of the connector and right. the wires going to it and whatnot.
So since the story broke kind of about the power concerns, AMD set about trying to fix it, right? And they released a driver today that actually addresses the problem in two distinct ways, mm-hmm. which is interesting, right? So the first problem or the first fix integrated is actually through microcode to the PWM, to the phase controller, to the power controller on the board,
mm-hmm.
right? So this is not something you enable in the driver or disable. If you have the driver in this card, it's just going to implement the fix. And what it does is it simply rebalances how much power is drawn from the 6-pin connection versus how much is drawn from the 12-volt on the motherboard.
Mm-hmm. And the good picture to look is right there of the card itself, where you've got, you know, some phases on top there labeled 1, 2, 3, and then the other three labeled 4, 5, 6.
Yep.
1, 2, 3 is drawn from the 6-pin connector. 4, 5, 6 is drawn from the slot. Well, the way the card shipped, it was drawing the same from both. And that first fix kind of shifts the bias a little bit. There's a controller that drives those four, you know, those four phases there, and it can be reconfigured slightly. It can't do it. It can't go to an extreme degree, but it can give you like a decent amount of a shift. From draw more from the 6-pin versus less from the plus 12 volts of the slot. And that was their first half of the fix, which that happens just automatically. You install that driver. Every time you reboot and it, you know, when every time the driver initializes, it goes, oh, you have a 480. And it sends the correct commands to that controller and reconfigures it.
Right.
Even though the BIOS of the card, like when the card starts up on its own before the system boots, that BIOS is still doing the thing it used to do. Like default configuration.
Right.
But the driver kind of does like a soft patch every time you boot.
Yep.
To the
Which is an interesting thing about it, right? And I would assume that future cards would implement this in VBIOS. Yeah. You know, cards that are manufactured after this fix is made, partner cards, they could fix it through VBIOS or they could fix it by changing the power delivery system.
If you're one of those people that are really into overclocking and you already mess with VBIOS stuff already, there's already VBIOSes out there. They were actually out there before this fix from AMD came,
right?
Where if you knew what you were doing, again, you got to really be kind of careful with this. You're flashing firmware to your video card. But there were, VBIOSes with the fix already applied with that part of the fix.
Right.
But there is a second half to the fix.
And as you point out, like, you don't need to apply that to the VBIOS. Like, there's no functional difference.
Right.
It does having the driver do it versus it being
the same end result.
Into a VBIOS.
Yeah.
The second part of the fix is more towards lowering the total power draw of the GPU, mm-hmm. regardless of whether or not you're drawing more or less from which power source. Mm-hmm. We want to bring
pull everything
down.
Yeah.
And it does this through lowering thermal thresholds, slight V-core adjustments. And it does more than I expected it to do. And it's in the driver. It's called compatibility mode, which is a horrible name.
Yeah.
Which I guess what they're trying to insinuate with this is like, hey, if you're worried about your motherboard, if you have a system that shuts down.
Which if it did before, it probably won't now. It
probably wouldn't with this new driver.
Yeah.
But if there's an issue where it still did, you can enable this and it will draw even less power from your 12 volt over your motherboard connection.
Right.
And I think what we saw is like both of these fixes were developed in tandem internally.
Yeah,
trying to figure out which one works best, which one they could get implemented more quickly. And it turned out they both kind of came together at the same time. They're like, well, no need to waste one.
Right.
Right. When we could actually fix the problem. And as it turns out, the combination of two, like if you look at our power measurements with the compatibility mode on versus the compatibility mode off with the new driver,
mm-hmm.
it's only with the
both
phase
things.
Adjustment and the compatibility mode on that we actually see the card in circumstances go below or at the 5.5 amp spec for the motherboard slot.
Yep.
Right. So it was actually necessary to get it to meet the spec,
mm-hmm.
either because AMD didn't want to be more aggressive on the power split or they couldn't be more aggressive on the power split.
Yeah, I think it's based on what I've seen, like that's as hard as you can drive tell that controller to drive one half versus the other half. Like, it just does, the numbers don't go any higher to reconfigure that thing.
Yeah. So it is the combination of the two that actually makes it work the best.
Right.
Now, obviously, when you're just lowering total power of the GPU, you have the risk of lowering performance as well.
Yes.
With the power split, we didn't, right? You were still drawing the same amount of watts, but you were just splitting where those watts came from.
Mm-hmm.
When you're lowering total power draw, you are kind of fundamentally either adjusting clocks down or adjusting thermal thresholds down, something that would affect performance.
Yep.
We did some performance evaluations as well on the last page of the story to kind of double check that that was the case. AMD kind of said in their statement that, hey, we've been working on other stuff as well, performance improvements of about 3%.
Yeah.
That we'll implement with this driver to offset any of those performance deltas that may have occurred because of the compatibility mode option.
Yep.
And as it turns out, it's exactly the case.
Yeah. And on the last page, the green lines are compatibility mode on. And other than it just being shifted over to the left a little in the chart there, they're pretty much right exactly identical to either the original driver or the update driver. So
probably even within that 3% window. It's interesting. Yeah. Like, if you look at actually that graph right there is a good one. The orange line is the new driver with compatibility mode off.
Correct.
With the extra power drop off.
Right.
And that's a little bit higher than everything. Right.
Yeah.
So if you look at the black line, which is kind of hidden there, that was the old driver.
Mm-hmm.
And then the new driver is maybe that's 3% faster, as it turns out. Right.
Yeah.
But if you turn on the compatibility mode, it drops the performance a little bit, constraining power consumption.
Mm-hmm.
But you're equaling the performance of where we were on launch day.
So the end result was they were about to give themselves an extra 3% boost.
Yeah.
But they said, oh, crap. We have power things.
Yes.
Okay. And then they kind of gave up that 3% that they were going to get. So
exactly.
In the end, like, people that are so worried if we do this drive, like, in my mind, the right way to do this, unfortunately, it requires one extra step for the user to do other than just updating the driver. Like, the right way should be install the driver and turn the compatibility mode on.
Yes.
Right. If you really are worried about that. Now, realize originally that power draw in that slot was as much as 50% past what it was supposed to be,
mm-hmm,
right?
Mm-hmm.
With just the driver alone, it brings you down to like 10, 15% past it, something like that, around roundabouts, right?
Yeah.
So if you're comfortable with that, don't worry about throwing the switch and you'll get potentially an extra 3% boost in performance, right? If you're not comfortable with that, you have to make the extra step, go into that control panel of the driver, turn on compatibility mode.
Yeah.
Then you will be either under or right on that limit. Which is, it's okay. Like, we can't really fault them. Like, they got it under.
Yeah.
Right.
And I would even say that if I were a user, I would not enable the compatibility mode. If I bought this card and I had reasonable hardware, right?
Yeah.
Not a $10 motherboard you bought used on eBay that may have been used for Bitcoin mining or something like that, right?
Mm-hmm.
That I would just install the new driver, the 16.7.1 driver, let it
just
adjust the power split and be done with it.
Yeah.
And you would almost assuredly have no problems.
Yeah.
But if you're a little bit concerned about it, or
if you're doing quad crossfire.
Yeah. If you're kind of
pushing the limits there. If you have a motherboard that does not have extra auxiliary power connectors, like some boards have an extra MOLX.
Yep.
To supply you some extra juice to the 12 volts of the PCI slots. If you don't have stuff like that and you're trying to go crazy on crossfire stuff, then you might need to turn compatibility mode on.
Right. To me, I'll kind of conclude on saying that AMD did a very good job addressing it quickly. It's been exactly 1 week since I posted my story about power consumption being poorly managed on the card. So 1 week to engineer, to discuss, engineer, test, validate, and including it was over Canada Day and the 4th of July holiday.
Yeah.
Always, you know, make sure we understand that as well. That they actually did a really good job getting this out there. I think it addresses the problems. You know, for the sticklers out there, like, if you're NVIDIA, you still say AMD released a card that was outside of spec. It's still technically outside of spec, right? Because like, Metro at 4K is over 5.5, it's 5.75 amps, even with both settings turned on, right? So, or the driver and the compatibility mode turned on. So,
you
still have that little difference, right? It's not perfect, but I think it's way, way better than it used to be, where we were drawing over 7 amps at stock settings and over 8 amps on overclock settings that we were able to drop it as much as they did. So the issue should be, I'm not gonna say it's put to rest, because now every card that comes out, you know, partner card for 480, other cards from NVIDIA, they're all gonna be like, there's gonna be a magnifying glass right. over every little bit of power consumption stuff that comes out now, which is annoying because it's kind of a pain in the ass process to test. You have to use a bunch of different equipment. But obviously that's something we'll have to do. So if you're interested in more of that, go to pcpro.com and check out the story, both the original one and this one that kind of explain the original problem and then the fixes for it as well. Next up, this is something, it's not new, but it is interesting. The Lenovo ThinkPad X1 Yoga, which mm-hmm. which is this weird combination of things.
Yeah, it's a merging of two different things, basically.
Well, three things in my mind. The ThinkPad is a laptop.
Right.
The ThinkPad X1 was like the X1 Carbon, which is like the thin, ultrabook style design of a ThinkPad, which existed before.
Uh-huh.
And now we have the X1 Yoga. And Yoga is this idea of a two-in-one convertible device that can flip and go into tent mode and stand mode and all these other types of things. And they've kind of mashed all of these together in this device. They had ThinkPad Yoga before, but they didn't have a ThinkPad X1 Yoga. So like the thin, sexy version that is also has all these different modes in it.
It is a little thicker.
It is. It's than a normal ThinkPad X1.
Like an X1, yeah.
Yes. And, you know, some of that comes from, like, the hinge hardware there. Like, you have to design things a little bit differently. You have to design the structure of the notebook a little bit differently when it's not always in clamshell mode.
Right.
Right? Plus, you have to be at, like, the monitor. The screen folds all the way back, right? Mm-hmm. So it can lay flat. So how do you, you know, have to adjust the tension for all of that? And I think it's actually a really, really nice design. Sebastian did this article, and he really came away liking the device. In terms of hardware, it's like every Skylake Ultrabook. It's a dual core hyper-threaded, 8 gigs of memory, 256 gig SSD. Like, the specs are not enticing really at all. They're all pretty much the same.
I really love that trick these guys do with the keyboard when you fold it over backwards.
Yes.
It's actually, it's visible in a picture on the first page where it's
on the hinge,
where it's hinged around the other way, but the keys all like suck into the keyboard.
Yes.
So that if you're laying it flat, the keys aren't just being mashed
yep.
on the table.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah. I forget what they call it. They have a specific name for that, but the keys retract into the keyboard when you flip it around, which is
and then I believe they also do when you close it. I think before the screen closes,
I guess
they pull in too.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Because I have that issue. I've had that not with this machine, but with other machines where, like, if you close it and you lift it up, you can sometimes see
the outline of all the keys
on your screen, uh-huh. right? Because you've got grease and oil and whatever on your fingers, and then it gets on the screen in that particular pattern, and it's like,
yep,
kind of dumb.
Yeah.
Lenovo feature would in theory fix that. Yeah, that's a really good shot of the retraction.
It's like you're hitting every key at once.
It's got, you know, it's got good connectivity. It's a ThinkPad device. So you got three USB, full-size USB 3.0 ports, a mini display port, a full-size HDMI. It's got a digitizer pen. It is, you know, it's obviously a touchscreen device. If you have a digitizer pen, the digitizer pen works really well. It's a ThinkPad in build quality. It's a ThinkPad in battery life. And it does really, really well in that regard.
It's a workhorse. These things are meant to be workhorses.
Yeah, and Many times throughout the life of me having this XPS 13, I miss having a ThinkPad for some particular reason, whether mm-hmm. it be the keyboard or the kind of the build of it, you know, the not having fear of dropping it other than ruining a nice, cool thing you have. It's still pretty good. Battery life on it was over 7 hours in our Wi-Fi browsing test. That's pretty good. Digitizer pen. I'm becoming more a fan of this idea continuously. I like the idea of having the Huawei MateBook and it having an active pen and being able to write notes and stuff like that. But it's not a perfect laptop,
right?
This looks more like it could be a nearly perfect laptop, like clamshell laptop. And then, I'm doing testing, flip it over, you know, write notes like I want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, you know, in the pen goes inside the device, you don't have to worry about losing it. Whereas on the Huawei MateBook, you have that weird hoop thing, the magnetic loop that goes around. That's not great. So they're not cheap. The one that we looked at was $1,549, but you can find it online for about $200 less. Lenovo's usually running sales and deals on that type of thing. And if you get the non-carbon, the non-X1, if you just get the ThinkPad Yoga, that starts at $1,099. So if you kind of want the clamshell plus flexibility feature of Yoga, but you don't necessarily need this, the ultra thin and light.
Right.
And maybe I don't think the Yoga can have any expandable batteries because you wouldn't be able to bend.
No, there's nowhere to put
the monitor to the display back.
Yeah.
That might be a problem. But those start at $1,099 if you're a little bit interested in that. So that's pretty cool. I don't have a need for a new notebook.
Yeah.
I kind of want one now. It's just like,
after looking at that.
Yeah, it's like that with the Huawei MateBook and some other things. It's just like,
it's kind of all those things.
And every time I have to use the webcam on this XPS 13, I want to scream.
Yeah, they put it in a bad place.
It's not perfect. Do you know what's pretty close to perfect as well?
What?
How about our first sponsor of this week's episode, Ring Video Doorbell?
Hey, I got one of those.
I have one as well. Did you know there's a home burglary every 13 seconds?
I didn't.
Now you know. Most burglaries happen in broad daylight. They'll ring your doorbell to make sure you're away before breaking in. Ring Video Doorbell has been proven to stop burglaries before they happen by allowing you to see and speak to anyone approaching your door using your smartphone. Now Ring is using their advanced motion detection technology to protect your entire property with the Ring of Security Bundle Kit, or Pro Bundle Kit. Both kits include a Ring Video Doorbell, a stick-up cam, a chime, a solar panel. That's pretty interesting. The Pro Bundle includes a slim video doorbell pro with crystal clear 1080p HD video and night vision. It's hardwired, so it never needs to charge. The wireless and weatherproof HD stick-up cam keeps an eye on other parts of your property and allows you to hear and speak to visitors with two-way talk. And with their optional cloud video recording, you can easily capture and share video with family, friends, and law enforcement, which is good. Plug the chime into any standard power outlet to know when you have a visitor, even if your phone is in another room. And we are actually both users of Ring. We have one here at the office. You have one at the house. I have the chime.
I even have the recording thing.
Oh, do you?
Option turned on for mine. Yeah.
The chime is good. It's not really necessary for the small office we have here. But if you're at a house, right, and you have a Ring doorbell that is maybe just using the battery-powered version instead of the hardwired version, you put the chime upstairs in the hallway so that if you're in your bedroom, you can hear it if your phone's not with you, those types of things. So it's a Wi-Fi connected extension of the chime, of the sound of the Ring video doorbell.
Yeah. And if you're replacing a real doorbell with it, like it goes in place of the doorbell and it still works. Like it still rings your doorbell.
Yes,
inside correct. The house. Like just it, like how your button
electric,
used to.
Yeah.
Yeah. It does the same thing electrically. So. Yep. You know, you still have your old doorbell, too.
Yep.
It's not like you lose that.
The Ring Video Doorbell and Stick-Up Cam install in just minutes working together. They provide 24/7 monitoring for your entire home, whether you're in the living room or thousands of miles away. Join the hundreds of thousands who protect their home with Ring. For a limited time, this week, and computer hardware listeners can save $50 off of one of the Ring of Security kits, the bundle kit or the pro bundle kit. Go to ring.com/twitch, T-W-I-C-H, to take advantage of the lowest price anywhere. That's ring.com/twitch. And I didn't know about the solar panel and stuff.
Yeah, neither did I.
So, that's...
must be a new thing.
Pretty cool. Back to the content. We're going to talk about the world's fastest SSD.
Pretty much.
Not a cheap SSD.
No.
But the world's fastest SSD, and that's important. This is the Micron 9100
Max. 9100 Max.
Okay. Yeah. So what this is, I mean, it's not a consumer drive.
No.
Right? It is an enterprise drive. What makes it an enterprise drive versus a consumer drive, other than price, perhaps?
Its firmware is just written to be able to handle sustained random access across like the whole span of the drive. Like consumer drives will have different firmwares and different levels of provisioning. This one, a consumer drive would have like a 5 or 7% extra flash on it compared to what you can use for your operating system or whatever you want to put on it, your data. This guy, it is a 2.4 terabyte drive, which is pretty large in itself.
Yep.
But there is 4 terabytes of flash on it.
Yeah, I'm not.
That's a lot of overprovisioning.
That's 1.6 terabytes of flash.
Yes.
That is not accessible through your operating system, but is used to maintain performance levels yes. for a long period
you're
of time.
You're spreading your writes over a lot more
right.
space.
Correct.
Which enables it to have just higher overall performance, even if you're doing something crazy like 4K random access to, across the whole thing. Right. So 2.4 terabytes worth of 4 kilobyte random writes.
Which is a tough task.
This right. thing can do that all day long. Okay. Like, it's just designed to be able to hack that, right? So you're thinking, you know, database servers, like just stuff where it's an enterprise environment. It's just getting really beaten up pretty badly, okay. right? And I mean, it's rated
at 3 gigabytes per second reads and 2 gigabytes per second writes.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And we've seen that before. No, I guess we haven't. Even on an NVMe drive, not 3x2.
Well, 3 and 2, they come close. Okay. It's usually about that. Even like the P3700 was about that in its ratings. It might not have hit that necessarily.
But it's that IOPS
The IOPS is where this thing is amazing, because so that 3 gig per second reads, 2 gig per second writes, this drive with a high enough queue depth can almost do 4 kilobyte random access at the same throughput. So you're talking 750,000 random read IOPS, 300,000 random write IOPS. So it's like 750,000 IOPS random from a single device, like, which is up there.
So when we did our
750 series crazy
raid
thing,
multiple that, what did we get there?
With data on the drives and stuff, like cracking 1 million was tough.
Yeah. And that was with
four or five of them.
Right.
Right.
Gotcha.
Yeah. So this is doing, you know, 750,000. It's just a single device. You can still have a raid of these.
Right.
You'd probably hit the point where you're running out of CPU cores in the system to be able to handle that much stuff. But, you know, it is out there. There are, you know, Xeon processors with a bunch of cores, and people are going to put together crazy storage servers using these things. We're doing some new kind of testing here, actually, that they're showing right now. And we're just presenting results to try to catch any possible potential buyer of this thing. They're going to have their particular kind of workload that they're going to want to do. And they'll say, well, I'm doing 70% reads and 30% writes or whatnot. And we just plotted all of them, like from 100% write to 100% read all the way across.
Yeah.
And that gives you, you know, we're just kind of providing the average IOPS you would get at all the different queue depths that you might hit the drive with. But on the next page there, which is showing on the screen now, is where we're kind of doing some new stuff. And that is, we are trying to better emulate what happens in an actual server. So when you build these actual servers using these things, they're not going to be running at queue depth 256, you know, 200 or 750,000 IOPS all the time. Like, they're just not. It may be capable of that, but if you designed your system to run only at the max all the time, like, you're going to start missing things. If it's like a transaction server for online transactions,
okay,
some transactions are just going to start timing out and stuff if you're running it all the way at the limit. So the way we're doing comparative tests now is to run it at a paced workload, which is to kind of emulate what would really happen in the server it was installed in. Like, you'd only have so many transactions per second happening that this thing was trying to record, for example, or access. And we're applying that same workload across both, in this case, two things that were competing, this drive versus the Intel P3700, which was previously just a powerhouse of an SSD.
Right.
And this one kind of made fun of that one. It really did, especially if you look at the quality of service results, which is, again, at a paced workload, which is not something that people typically rate them for, because I just don't think they either had the capability or just, it's just, that's the way they've always done it. The way we're doing it, in my mind, is a more equal footing kind of a test, because we're putting the same load on both. And if it's 100% random writes, like what that chart is on the screen right now, that is something like a 400 times improvement in latency for this new drive versus the P3700. So it's those 99.9% kind of figures at the bottom there just equate to how long is the, and on the case of the right side, how long is the 99.999th longest IO? Like, okay, if you were to look at all of them, like, what's the absolute longest one? You're trying to catch what's called tail latency, which is sometimes you'll have outliers that just kind of took too long, right? Those are the ones that are going to result in something timing out. And usually the limits kind of, like, the quality service, the target for people will tend to be something like 2 milliseconds, 3 milliseconds, something like that. maybe
before 10, you just kind of give up.
Maybe 10 milliseconds. It depends on the server. It depends on how you configure it, right? But with that workload, the P3700, which was not, we weren't pushing it super hard. We were pushing it at half its rated spec.
Mm-hmm.
And it still took something like 19 milliseconds for the outliers versus this drive, which was still like 0.08 milliseconds for the outliers. Like this drive's worst outlier is, you know, 80 microseconds.
That's impressive.
So, which is pretty darn good, right? So this stuff is obviously progressing and getting much faster. And now it's probably Intel's turn to come out with something. I would bet that they're just kind of holding off for cross-point stuff.
Gotcha.
Because cross-point is, there just isn't going to be any outliers, probably. Like, just everything is going to go super fast. But it's not here yet. So we just kind of got to wait for that stuff to come out.
Mm.
Yeah.
So we talked about the RX 480 for a little bit. NVIDIA is, they're going to talk about, they announced today, actually, their competitor to the RX 480, the GeForce GTX 1060. Now, there aren't reviews out today. This is just kind of just like a preview announcement, a generalized collection of specifications and information.
Yeah.
It looks like that. It looks very similar to other cards. It's built a little bit cheaper, more plastic, less metal. There's not a window there. It's actually like a painted black section in the middle. It looks fine. This is the Founders Edition, obviously.
They're doing a Founders Edition again.
Well, they're doing a Founders Edition limited. The other Founders Editions were not limited.
Okay.
Meaning that they were going to exist for the entire life of the product. This one is limited, meaning that it's probably only going to be at launch. July 19th is when the cards will be available. Partner cards will be available on July 19th as well, I'm told. Price for the partner cards will start at $249. The Founders Edition is $299. That's a $50 difference. That's a pretty big delta for a $250 video card. So, makes it. Also, we should point out, like, it's so limited that the Founders Edition is only going to be sold on NVIDIA.com, anywhere else, right? So it's not going to be like an EVGA or an ASUS Founders Edition or whatever. So.
But the partner cards are expected to be like around $200?
$250. Or $299 for Founders, $250 for partner cards.
I was kind of thinking it'd be like $200,
$250. Well, keep in mind that this card is $239.
Yeah.
With 8 gigs of memory.
Sure.
The specs on the GTX 1060 are 6 gigs of memory, running at 8 gigabits per second.
Uh-huh.
It has, in terms of core count, it is exactly half of the core count of a GTX 1080. So you got 1,280 cores.
Okay.
Base clock of 1506, boost clock of 1700 megahertz.
So then, like, how should that perform, at least on paper, compared to a 480?
So NVIDIA says that it is 15% faster than an RX 480.
Okay.
And 70% more power efficient, right?
But, yeah, it is more than 15% higher cost. Kind of. No, it's not.
No,
not
for, it's 10 not bucks for... more in theory. Right?
Yeah,
if availability and pricing.
If you got the non-Founders Edition, you got to add, a partner card or something like that.
I'm just going with the lowest cost for both.
Okay, you know,
it's 100. It's not here. It's 120. I could have brought it over. It's 120 watt TDP instead of 150 watt TDP.
Yeah,
it also only has one 6-pin power connector, so we'll have to measure it through our same process to see.
Should be okay.
And I would imagine it
we'll probably draw more from the 6-pin and stuff. Does that other VR works whatever stuff apply to this? It's the same architecture, right?
Yeah, so it's Pascal. It's a new chip. It's GP106 instead of GP104. So it's actually a new die. It's a smaller chip. There were rumors, and I actually thought it was going to be true, that this card was going to be using another cut-down version of GP104, but that clearly wasn't the case.
But will it be able to do all those VR things that haven't necessarily been rolled out yet?
Simultaneous multi-projection. Yeah, that's still a part of it. Yeah, VR, single-pass shading.
Okay.
All that is in there.
I mean, that potentially gives it even more of an edge down the line, but it has to be stuff that comes out for VR.
Now, we haven't done our testing on it yet because I didn't get a driver until today, but, you know, the 15% faster, I have to assume that means in just normal
games. Stuff. Yeah.
And in VR, they would use different quotes, higher quotes, right? Yeah. Because what they compare the new GTX 1060 to in their own family is a GTX 980. They say you're getting the performance of the GTX 980 and the GTX 1060. So the GTX 980 launched at $499, I think.
Okay.
And this is launching at $249.
Not bad.
That's not bad. I mean, it's been what? 2 years, a year and a half, you know. So, I mean, there's an improvement. And there's already people online complaining that the GTX 960 launched at $199. So, this is actually a price increase generational from generation to generation, which, sure, whatever. We'll be curious to see if the 15% holds up against the RX 480.
Yep.
If it does, and there's availability, which is another big caveat.
Sure.
That's a big hit to the RX 480, right? In terms of
it is
the 8 gigabyte being only $10 less. If it's 15% slower, if it's more power efficient, what does that mean? NVIDIA was also talked about in their little announcement yesterday that they had 30 games in development that were going to support simultaneous multi-projection. So if you do multi-monitor stuff or single pass shading on VR.
So, I mean, a lot of these
Unreal
are...
and Unity both integrate the technology now.
Oh, okay.
So, like, in theory, we'll be seeing a lot of games that do SMP.
Yeah, it's just that people that are making, and for existing titles, that's VR titles, like, people just have to update their titles to support it.
They would have to, yes.
NVIDIA did say it was pretty easy to implement, but of course, like...
Of course they would say that.
Well, yeah. It was, like, you know, not that many lines of code even. Like, it was just a matter of how you're, you know, doing your video output to the...
One thing to keep in mind is that this card does not have an SLI connector. One or two SLI connectors, for that matter.
Really?
Yeah. So if you look at the back of the PCB, it's funny. If you actually look really closely, you can see indentations in the PCB where they would have been cut out for it, probably.
Huh.
As well as, like, the PCB is kind of bare. Scroll down. It's towards, I think it's the last image. There you go. Right there.
Yeah.
And when I asked, NVIDIA said, yeah, we're not supporting SLI on the GTX 1060.
Well, you did say it's literally half of a 1080, right?
Yes.
Like, basically, it's split right down the middle. It's a different chip, technically.
But it's got more than half of the memory bus and,
yeah,
and texture units and ROPs and stuff like that. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Yeah. So maybe they're just... Well, but wait. How much is 1080 right now?
$699 for the Founders Edition, $599 without it.
So that's more than twice the cost.
Yeah, it would be.
I don't know. I just feel like there's people out there that would want an SLI.
I agree with you. NVIDIA says that, oh, this is not the audience that runs SLI. And I don't agree with that. Like, I think...
You'd have people that would buy one of these.
How many people SLI 960s?
Yeah. You'd have people that would buy one of these, and then later on, they might be able to afford a second one.
Right.
Like, it's the budget card.
I would agree.
Right? So...
And NVIDIA has been on this, you know, this path of two-way SLI is the way to go. We're not going to support three or four-way.
Yeah, they're trying to back off on SLI in general.
We've decided that discussion.
Yeah. I've personally always just been in favor of having a single big GPU as opposed to having, you know, there's less stuff to deal with. Yeah. You know,
if you think you want to get two 1060s, maybe just save up and get one 1080.
Yeah.
Yeah. Save the extra $100 or $75. You're going to have a better experience that way. Now, one thing that's worth noting that I saw on Twitter that I didn't realize initially is, like, if you're using DX12 explicit device.
Yes.
Multi-GPU, like what Ashes of the Singularity uses. It doesn't matter if it has an SLI connection.
That's true.
Right. So if you have if a lot of DirectX 12 games end up taking advantage of that version of DX12 multi GPU implementations, then you could buy two 1060s or whatever.
Yeah.
Right.
But you're limited to that subset of games.
Yes.
For the performance advantage.
For multi GPU to work at all.
Yeah.
Yes. Yep. So that'll be an interesting concern to look at. We have some, like, leaked performance numbers in this story as well, but that's pretty much where it is. We'll know more on July 19th when the reviews go up. And partner cards, I have a Founders Edition card here, and I'll have a partner card here tomorrow as well. So we'll have availability of both of these. No. Yeah, and if you look down at the little list I made below it, where, you know, based on these leaked numbers, which take for whatever you will, the 1060 is 8.5% faster than the RX 480. And 17% faster than a GTX 970, but 6.5% slower than a 980.
All right.
So that's kind of where it looks to be sandwiched in. But again, these are leaks, maybe not be a final driver, et cetera, et cetera. So we'll see more on that in the not too distant future, I guess 12 days or so. And then speaking of graphics cards and availability and all that other stuff, you still can't really find a whole bunch of video cards.
That's true.
People
wanted to upgrade.
Now in stock.net is the best place to go. I'm going to refresh the page right here. I check every morning.
Which card do you got open?
This is the 1070, and I see
some in stock.
7, 8, 10, 10, 11 GTX 1070s in stock.
Right.
Now the problem is, and this is a very fair complaint, is that all of these cards are $449 or above, or so. I think there's one for $439 listed here, which is...
This is the typical supply versus demand thing that happens.
Yeah, but these are actually retail prices, right? $449 is Founders Edition, and most of these that are in stock are Founders Editions. So they're going to be $459.
Sure.
And I don't really see, like, as I scroll down this list, kind of looking for cards that should be $300-something. Remember, the supposed MSRP is $379, mm-hmm. right?
Well, those are the ones that are going to blow out of stock immediately.
I guess. But, like, even the MSI GTX 1070 Aero OC, which is about the cheapest looking video card that you've seen for a GTX 1070, is still listed at $419. It's out of stock, but it's still listed at $419.
Yeah.
So there's some complaints there. The GTX 1080, I think there was one in stock when I started the podcast, and now it's gone.
Hey, you can pre-order.
But you can there's two in stock, one through Best Buy or the NVIDIA store. You can get the Founders Edition for $699. And then for the RX 480, let me check here.
Oh, wow.
None. Nothing in stock.
People want those too.
480. Yeah. 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 They still sell well. And I saw a listing. This is actually really interesting. Is it on here? Let's see. I saw a XFX Fury X. Let's see. Pricing cart is $399.
Wow.
Yeah, this is a card that launched at $549, right? So this is $160 less than that. Now, it kind of makes sense because AMD doesn't have a high-end GPU at this point.
Right.
NVIDIA has come out with new GPUs. Their GPUs are shifting down. This is kind of comparable to a GTX 980 Ti, which is somewhere around a 1070 that mm-hmm. sells for $399 to $449, so it kind of matches up with that.
Yep.
Now it's a totally different product, it's a totally different card. It's got 4 gigs of memory instead of 8. It's the Fiji based architecture, so it's less efficient. There's other things to deal with.
But they are starting to come down.
But they're starting to come down in prices. So if you're in the AMD market and you're looking for something like that, it might be worth doing. But that's our weekly stock check on graphics cards. Let's take a quick second here before we get to the rest of our bits of news from the week to thank the second of today's podcast sponsors. That is iFixit.com, your complete DIY electronics repair solution. We use their stuff all the time here.
Yep.
I feel like every toolkit we have.
I took this apart with it.
Is based on iFixit stuff.
I took this apart with it.
We did that. From their 21,000 plus free step-by-step repair guides and more than 80,000 solutions, to their huge inventory of replacement parts and tools with lifetime warranty, iFixit has got your repair needs covered. And they've been doing this for a long time, and they just keep getting better at it. Today, we're talking about their latest and greatest, the all-new ProTech Toolkit. It's gorgeous, completely reimagined design, but very rugged and portable. Easier to use. The tools are easier to access. Everything's kind of like magnetic mm-hmm. release, which is nice. It's got a new 64-bit driver kit, which replaced the former 54-bit. So you're getting 10 more bits. Don't ask me which ones they are, but there's 10 more bits in there than there were before. It's a more durable case, engineered without hinges, magnets. 64-bit kit itself is held to the tool roll using magnets.
Yep.
And then you can use that magnetic sheet underneath the tool kit to hold screws and stuff while you're working on things. Yep.
Or you can use the lid. Like if you have the lid open of the drivers,
yeah.
It just has a little pocket. Like it's just...
Oh, really?
Well, it's you know, it's dished.
So you
flip it on its back.
It becomes a bowl.
Yeah.
Essentially,
it's just a plastic bowl. You just put stuff in.
More bits means fewer repair roadblocks, easier to use, longer lasting, and cooler. Can't argue with that. Newly redesigned swivel top precision driver. I do like the driver better. It rotates in your palm much more smoothly.
Yeah.
Than the last one did. And they still have the flex extension for hard to reach screws. They have precision.
I like that kind of sort of spudger, the black with the spring steel on it.
Yeah.
That was to the left there. That thing is really handy. Because it's, you know, it was something where the plastic pry tools would just, you might, you know.
I believe they call that the metal spudger. iFixit's own rubber handled Jimmy pry tool.
Yeah. And it's actually a very durable thing. And, you know, it doesn't like bend and mangle itself when you're trying to open something that doesn't want to open.
You got ESD safe tweezers, including a pair of reverse tweezers, a wider variety of plastic opening tools and picks, suction cup, ESD safety strap, and more. The best part, it's backed by iFixit's lifetime warranty. Buy it because it's awesome, or don't, and you still get the free access to all their free repair resources on iFixit.com, which is obviously, that's how I first found iFixit.com.
Yeah.
Was looking up information and then finding that they sold all the tools and parts necessary to fix all your stuff. So you can grab an all-new ProTech toolkit and get going on your next fix, hack, or build. Just head over to iFixit.com/TWiT and use the code TWICH, TWICH, at checkout to save $5 on your purchase of just $10 or more. We thank iFixit for their support of This Week in Computer Hardware. Let's see. What do we want to jump through here? Real quick, another rumor of the Radeon RX 490. It was listed on a Sapphire support site in a drop-down selection of graphics cards.
Those things all day to come up in the weirdest places.
Yeah, it showed up in like a listing of prizes or like compatibility for something on AMD's own site, and now it's listed on Sapphire's site. So it's pretty clear the RX 490 is a thing.
Yeah.
But there's a debate on what it is.
Yeah. We don't know if it's two of something or...
Yeah.
You know, on one card or one bigger thing, one bigger GPU.
Yeah, the debate is it there's three options. It's either a Polaris 10 GPU that's like highly binned and overclocked and maybe has more power going into it and they can hit a higher speed bin
like
for
an 810.
Yeah. Or it's a new GPU, a total different die that is bigger, more performance. I find that the least likely option because I think we would have heard about it by now. Like these things leak out pretty regularly.
Yeah.
And the third option is that it is two Polaris 10s on a single PCB. And thus,
okay, you know that.
And I'm trying to think back like the naming schemes. There was a 7990. There was a 7970, which was a single GPU. And then there was a 7990, which was a dual GPU variant. Mm-hmm. So they've done that before. You had the 290 and the 295 X2. Mm-hmm. Right. So you can see how the naming scheme could work, fits in there. But a lot of that depends on how robust is multi-GPU support for Polaris and DX12 and all these other things that kind of go into that.
Right.
A dual GPU graphics card is less valuable today than it was 2-3 years ago.
Compared to
when everything was DX10,
GPU.
DX12, DX9, yeah. And SLI and Crossfire, the driver team could do it themselves.
Yep.
Now it's very much a different set of circumstances. If you're into trying beta things like operating systems, you can try the new GeForce Experience beta 3.0.
That's not an operating system.
It's not.
It's a driver.
Yeah.
Well, it's not even a driver.
It's a piece of software.
Yeah. It's the thing that does the shadow play and...
Yeah. It does shadow play. Know. It does... like
Twitch streaming,
recommended settings. It does Twitch streaming. But yeah. I think the coolest thing that it does is it's like, for people who don't want to get in the nitty-gritty of game settings, it's just... it knows your hardware,
yep.
Optimize your settings for the best playable experience, and then you can tweak from there. Yep.
It scans your system to see what games you got, and then it like can tweak your settings for all of them.
Now, the downside to this is apparently this is the version that's going to implement you have to log in to download drivers through GeForce Experience.
I still don't understand why.
I mean, I understand why they're doing it, right? They do it because they want an email list of people that they can contact when they have new products, when they do launches. They want to collect this database of their users. And they're very much, NVIDIA very much wants to have an ecosystem of their own, right? Sony and Micro, NVIDIA sees them as a competitor to Sony and Microsoft for gamers, right?
Okay.
Like platform, NVIDIA wants to be a platform. Right? They don't want to just make graphics cards, right? That's not their end goal. They want to be a platform. And so to be a platform, you got to have things like GFE, you got to have things like... custom technologies, got to have custom features, like very specific level or product level features. And having a user database, I guess, helps that as well. We talked about this yesterday. CoolChip makes a kinetic cooler, which is an interesting way to say what. What exactly does this cooler do? It looks kind of like a cooler with no fan in it. Looks like if you just saw it in this photo right here, it just looks passive. It
just looks like a heatsink.
But it's not.
Yeah, because that middle part spins.
Yeah, this middle part. So if you have cats, don't have an open test bed.
No.
With this.
No.
Because the middle part spins. But what is it spinning on? Like, what is the catch?
Just an air bearing. It's a flat piece of metal, really close to another flat piece of metal.
Yeah.
Like across the whole circumference of the bottom of that section.
Okay.
So if the two pieces are so close together that there's barely any air between them, then it doesn't really conduct directly. It's still like convection cooling, but it's convection cooling happening in such a small space that it's basically as if the two halves are at the same temperature.
Okay.
Right. So anything that heats up from the CPU on the bottom part, it just immediately transfers to the spinning heatsink. So now you don't have a fan trying to pull air through the heatsink. The heatsink itself is the thing forcing air across it.
Okay.
Which is kind of cool.
Yeah. Right?
It's just, you know, it's different design.
It's a different design. The idea is if you look at the image of it, you'll notice that like there's an interior place with very kind of coarse looking fins.
Yep.
And perpendicularly to it, like kind of facing the opposite direction, are thin aluminum fins that you're kind of used to seeing on heat sinks. And the air movement...
It's actually a turbine design.
Yeah. Like
that's how turbine blading is designed, that they oppose each other.
Right.
So that way you're just... ideally,
the
air
is forced through.
Well, the idea is that the air kind of wants to go in a straight line, you know. Whereas if you're channeling it one way and then you're channeling it the other way, it's like you get more airflow through the spinny part.
Gotcha.
Basically, to dumb it down.
And the benefit of what this tech is, because obviously we have CPU coolers, like water coolers.
Yeah.
This is very low profile, and
I don't think dust would affect that as badly.
Right. If it's an air bearing. Yeah.
Well, dust probably isn't going to get within that part. I think it would be much harder for it to physically just make it into there. But right. That's aside from the thing. Like, if there was any dust on it at all, it'd be like maybe some surface dust on the top of the thing. It wouldn't be like in all the nooks and crannies as badly. I suspect. Right.
Sure.
That outer ring, maybe, because there are channels in it that, you know, would be the same thing that happens on your typical kind of like, radiator style. You know, you're going to get some dust in that.
Yep.
But you wouldn't have dust really, like, there's really no place for dust to build up significantly on the center section.
I see. Right? Yeah.
So potentially, you know, less issues down the road.
Could be targeted at enterprise level stuff then.
Maybe. It is very low profile. You can have that in a
super low profile. Yeah. And that's when we saw it a couple of years ago at CES, and they were more demonstrating it as like, you can get this TDP of cooling in a smaller space than you could get.
Yep. They were going for the little home theater PC kind of stuff at the time.
So I don't know. We're trying to get a hold of one of those and see challenging convention kinetic cooling technology. So, and they're on the front page of the website, they have a quote from Willy Wonka.
Really?
Innovation is 93% perspiration, 6% electricity, 4% evaporation, and 2% butterscotch ripple.
That is definitely a Willy Wonka.
I'm not sure I follow the need for that quote on there, but hey, you know. For those of you that game on the PC and also game on the Xbox, new good information from Microsoft, where they talk about formalizing the idea of the Xbox Play Anywhere. They talk about all of the games that they announced at this year's E3, and we hope that this means all the games kind of going beyond that, are going to have the Play Anywhere label on them, which means they're going to be available on your Xbox One.
Mm-hmm.
And they're also going to be available on the PC through the Microsoft Store, through the UWP games system.
But you buy it one time.
You buy it one time, you get access to both.
That's pretty sweet.
And that's really good, right? Microsoft, I think, after falling behind in this latest console generation, mm-hmm. you know, the PS4 has been outselling it pretty handily, realized that rather than treating the PC like this stepchild over here to the side that we have to deal with, that as it turns out, it's actually a pretty big... net positive for us to have this whole user base of PC gamers,
right?
That may want to come over and vice versa, right? So they appear to be taking much more seriously than they have in the past the idea of Xbox as a brand for the PC and for console to kind of make gaming more ubiquitous, right? Like, Microsoft, I can imagine a developer coming to them and say, "Yes, there are this many PlayStation 4s. Let me show you how many Windows 10 PCs." There are that can support your game on our platform.
Right.
Right now, obviously, you run into the issues of hardware compatibility and all these different things. And
it's probably not that hard anymore to port stuff between those two platforms.
It shouldn't be. It's not, right?
Right.
But you still have the complication on the PC of a game developer needing to support, you know, to the nth degree hardware configurations, whereas on a console, you're supporting one, maybe two configurations at any given time. So, but, you know, these will be UWP apps, so it's important, again, that we keep Microsoft on track to update and improve their UWP system. They've been doing it. When they first launched, it was pretty much garbage.
Mm-hmm.
Now they've implemented G-Sync and FreeSync support. They've added V-Sync disablement, unlocked frame rates. Mm-hmm. Like, some of the things that people really wanted are now implemented into it.
Yep.
Still more to go.
But. UWP was the thing that actually kind of adds more abstraction from the hardware, all those random PC hardware configurations.
Yes.
So that's part of what the problem was initially with the G-Sync and, you know, the other support.
Yep.
But that same very platform would hopefully make it easier. It's like, you know, they can sell a game developer that's developing for console, be like, look, you know, here's this, you just cross-compile it for this other UWP thing. You make a couple of tweaks, but we'll handle all of the compatibility issues Like, that's good for, like, Microsoft will do the legwork there.
I would think so.
Yeah.
And I did learn last night that you can actually sell a UWP game on Steam, and it just downloads as one executable file that the UWP system on Windows handles and starts up as it normally would. So there's a chance that this might not be limited to the Windows Store. There's a chance, but we'll have to see. Obviously, Microsoft is only speaking for the Microsoft published games thus far. So all those will definitely be in the Microsoft Store and not Steam. So, but like some of these, like Ark Survival, Killer Instinct, State of Decay, some of these games that are console games, I think would be really cool to see them convert to the PC. What do you get out of it? Will it be just a dumb port? Maybe in some cases. Will it be a vastly improved port? Like Forza has been, maybe, right? Where Forza has 4K and higher texture up res. And, you know, as they improve the Xbox console with Scorpio platform, in theory, they want to be able to double up on all that work. So we should see that there. If you want to build a home theater PC, and you want that, when you get into that, you're always looking for the densest component selection possible, right? Most compute per space, right? Compute per space, 2.4 terabytes in this.
Yep.
If you remember, the R9 Nano was that, right? From AMD. Gigabyte is the first to show a small GTX 1070 mini ITX card.
That is a really small 1070.
And the mini ITX is kind of indicating the length of the PCB. It's still a dual slot card. It's still a full height card.
Is that even like length of a Nano or even shorter?
I don't know. It says 6.7 inches long. So if we look that up, the R9 Nano is 6 inches.
Okay.
So the R9 Nano is still smaller than this Gigabyte card.
It's pretty small though.
But this is a faster card. It's a GTX 1070. So you're going to get GTX 980 Ti-ish level performance out of it. It still has a single 8-pin power connector. It has an odd display output configuration of one HDMI, one DisplayPort, and two DVI.
Yeah, that's kind of weird.
I don't get it. It does have a 5+1 power phase design as opposed to the reference design, which is 4+1.
All right.
Pay more attention to that stuff again.
Yeah, we're all of a sudden very interested in power phases.
Yeah, before it was just like a nice little statistic. Still has an out-of-the-box base clock of 1,500 megahertz and a boost of 1,721. And they can actually OC that to 1,746. So you get another 2,500 megahertz out of it. And again, in a small, tiny space, that's pretty impressive. It's a pretty impressive little bit of hardware there.
Yeah, it is.
So no idea when it will be available, I think. But the pricing on it was $465. So $449 is the Founders Edition price for the 1070. So this is, you know, a little bit above that.
And that's like good for a home theater PC you actually want a game on.
Yeah. Yeah. That's got to be what their target is, right? It's just small form factor PCs, and then what are you going to do with them after that? So that's our news and reviews of the week in the world of computer hardware. Thank you guys for joining us. If this is your first time, if you need a general reminder, go to twit.tv/twitch. You can find the RSS files for your audio downloads, your video downloads. You can, you know, subscribe through iTunes, of course, and all those other methods there. And then obviously check out all the other shows on the TWiT TV network at twit.tv. There's a lot of other stuff on there. None as good as us, obviously, especially for covering PC hardware, as the name would imply. But a lot of good stuff on there as well. I assume Patrick will be back next week, but thanks for filling in for us this week, Allyn. I would tell you a preview of what's going to happen next week, but I honestly don't know at this point. GTX 1060 is not next week. It'll be the week after.
Yep.
So more stuff will happen in between now and then. So thank you, everybody, for joining us. We will see you next week on This Week in Computer Hardware. Thanks.